You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome. Today we're going to be discussing California politics. I will be having a guest speaker later throughout the segment of this session. He's a former state assembly member by the name of Rudy Bermudez. But first of all, we're going to be talking about propositions, initiatives, and referendums and how California politics works. I just wanted to note that I did extend the assignment for the public policy assignment due till tomorrow. It's due tomorrow the 18th by midnight. One of the reasons why I extended the public policy assignment is because I noticed that the link wasn't working properly. So that's the reason why I extended it. And for those of you who have already turned in your assignment, if you feel that you need to make changes prior to that, that's fine. I noticed there's quite a few of you. There's about very few students that actually turned their assignment. Kudos to you who have done that. But if you feel that you need to, that's fine. It's not due till tomorrow, the 18th. Also, since we're talking about California politics this week, we were originally going to talk about globalization. So the California politics assignment has been moved up. That's due next Monday, the 24th. And then after that, when we come back for spring break, it'll be globalization, which is April 7th. So one of the questions I would like to start off with is, who is your California State Assembly member? And who is your California State Senator? Would like for you to look that up, and for you to share that, you could either call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. Now, we've been talking a lot about the Constitution as of recently, about the presidency, about the Congress, but today we're going to take a look at specifically about California politics. Now, each state has their own constitution. So there's a California Constitution and there's also a federal U.S. Constitution. Now, the powers that are not enumerated in the U.S. Constitution are reserved to the states under the 10th Amendment, which gives the reason to have a constitution for the state. Now, in October 1849, a California state constitution was adopted, and in 1850, California became a state. And actually, California is one of the 31st states of our nation to be present. Now, the California Constitution is in many ways similar and a bit different to the U.S. Constitution. For example, the California Constitution, Article 3, it divides the state government into three different branches, which are the legislative, executive, and judicial, very, very much like the federal constitution. Also, the California Constitution, our main leader here for California politics is our governor, and as you know, as our nation, is our president. Now, the California Constitution allows the governor to line veto bills that have been submitted for approval, which means that the governor has the capability to accept some part of the bill and to reject some part of the bill by line item veto. So the president, on the other hand, he could only veto bills. So he can accept some bills and then accept some of the language of the bill and reject other ones, not like the governor has. So that's one of the differences. Also, too, our second in line to the governor is our lieutenant governor here in California, which is kind of equivalent to the U.S. vice president. Now, according to the Constitution, in Article 5, the lieutenant governor and the governor do not have to run on the same ticket like the president and the vice president of the U.S. So our current lieutenant governor is Gavin Newsom, who is the former mayor of San Francisco, and our current governor is Jerry Brown. Now, another thing about the judicial branch versus California and the U.S. is that judges are elected by the people and have term limits of up to 12 years. And for the U.S., Supreme Court judges are elected and they serve lifetime appointments. They are appointed by the president and they're confirmed by Congress and they serve lifetime appointments. Now, let's take a look at a video about introduction to California politics. Let's take a look at that.
Paradise was called California. And when the Dons came to the Pacific, they looked around and realized that they were obviously in California.
Well, California is amazing. I'm an eighth generation Californian, so I think that people who live anywhere else are nuts.
What it makes California different is its size, its cost.
Well, California is just so big.
But it does start with people.
It's really big.
So thoroughly different between the North and the South.
The county of Los Angeles has 10 million people.
Activism has been a big part of the history of California.
We have 34 Democrats in Congress. That's 1 in 7 Democrats across the whole nation.
How could California politics be more interesting? I mean, what, Arnold Schwarzenegger running against Sylvester Stallone?
The politics in California are really Byzantine, and it's not just the politics, it's the way the government is run.
Is California governable? Is it ungovernable?
You know, I think Governor Schwarzenegger has probably the most difficult job in the world.
He ran the smartest campaign I ever saw to get to be the governor. And then he was a bad governor.
The governor has the power of the pen in that he creates the initial budget. He has blue pencil authority. He can also veto bills. So he has a big role.
Basically, the governor is a figurehead and has been for almost 75 years.
The Democrats in the legislature don't want to raise taxes on the lower and middle class folks. The Republicans don't want to raise taxes on anybody.
Meg is actually campaigning on cutting more, on more job cuts, which is just absolutely crazy in an economic crunch. And Jerry Brown is just saying, I'm not going to raise taxes. Well, that's a nice simplistic soundbite, but it's certainly not leadership. It doesn't address the problem.
We traditionally have not been that good at that. We have a tendency to talk to people and talk at people and not listen.
California Republicans are going to have to get back to basics, go back to the way Ronald Reagan did it, with good old-fashioned volunteers calling neighbors, neighbor-to-neighbor cards, direct mail, and phones.
The thing about the Democratic Party is it's really full of people who don't want to do anything but preserve their status.
Speaker Perez and Pro Tem Steinberg's taco truck throwdown party. Oh, yeah!
California produces over 400 different commodities, and it also produces over 50% of this nation's fruits, nuts, and vegetables.
California is magic land when it comes to growing things, and that should be protected.
We are in the fourth year of a drought. Half of the farms in the Central Valley have not been able to grow crops. Part of it is there's not enough water. Secondly, it's too costly, perhaps. And third, they don't want to invest if they don't know whether they're going to be able to actually water.
Water is the biggest problem. There are some towns that have 35% unemployment, which is all farm labor, most of these Latino families that don't have jobs. And that 35% is just the reported unemployment.
Being able to grow our own fruits and vegetables and crops in California is going to be so, so important.
The regulations and the rules are tougher. The tax base is tougher. There's not a lot of incentive for small business to actually start small businesses in this state.
Voters want to get the economy back on track. They want jobs. And I think that's going to be the absolute number one dominating issue.
Yeah, being broke is our biggest issue, and not being able to get out of it is our biggest issue.
We have a revenue system that is based on a 20th century economy. We used to be a production, manufacturing state. We no longer are. We are high tech. Biotech, internet-based, yet our tax system does not reflect the new economy.
California's economy is vibrant. We have so much wealth here in California, but the crazy and tragic thing is that our budget is being starved because we have this crazy two-thirds rule, which is completely the antithesis of democracy.
So look, for me, California is about one thing, Prop 13.
We're one of only three states that has a two-thirds majority requirement to pass the budget.
You know, how can we make California a better place without running these deficits, without just adding on deficit spending, without raising taxes on working families?
But this is not about having their taxes raised. When people hear the term raise taxes, they think it means raise my taxes. It's a phony issue. The question is, do they want to have taxes raised on corporations? Because that's the only thing that raise taxes would now mean.
It's been a real nightmare for this state. And so Prop 13 absolutely has to be overturned.
Yeah, I disagree with removing the two-thirds. And I would like to see, because I think what it does, I think two-thirds, just like 60% in the United States Senate, it forces people to work together.
Right now, we need at least 6 Republicans to vote. If all the Democrats went up on a budget or any type of tax increase, revenue increase, we don't have that.
14 conservatives can run the state.
California, which by itself is one of the richest countries in the world, should have an unencumbered representative democracy.
If somebody were to show you a flow chart of the way California is run, if you looked at that thing, it just looks like spaghetti.
So check this out. The bill starts over here on the left, and then you go over here and the DVD player gets... Wait a minute.
We can have healthy children. Our children don't have to be obese. We don't have to lock up disproportionate numbers of African Americans and Latinos.
And now they're trying to privatize the best university system in the world.
We are now in California dead last in the nation in terms of per pupil spending.
They're making ignorance a virtue. They should be flogged in the public square.
Nobody makes a dime in this state without protection and empowerment by the government.
It's not looking at people by labels, it's looking at people as Californians. And what is in the best interest of the working families of this state?
California is the same thing that happens in Fresno, same thing that happens in Sacramento and in San Diego and all the other places I've had the opportunity to be engaged with. The work is the same. The communities are different. How you engage with those communities is where the opportunity is.
And you've got to remember the fun of it all. There's a fun part here.
Okay. So provide a really good background information about California politics, which we are discussing today. Once again, we are recording live here in Carson, California at Cal State Dominguez Hills. One of the questions that I did ask is, who is your state assembly member and who is your state senate member? You can call in at 1-800-339-1193 or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. Now, going back to California politics, our state operates like a hybrid government, which means that we have both a representative and also it's part direct democracy. So representative means that we elect someone to represent us, for instance, our state assembly or state senate. And then it's part democracy because there are tools that have been set up in the system that allows for us to have a direct democracy. And these are initiative, referendum, and recall. Those are the ability that the people have to implement. Now, measures, basically, which are initiatives, in other words, can be proposed by any citizens. It could be at the local level, it could be at the county level, and at the state level. Any registered voter may propose a law, which is known as an initiative. Also, too, when this happens, when a citizen feels that they want to create an initiative, there can be a problem with time and money because it does cost time and money to put a proposition or initiative on the ballot. So what really happens is that well-funded interest groups end up dominating the system. So in order for a measure to qualify, the first step is to write up the law, to draft or write the proposed law. Also, too, the proposed initiative must be submitted to the Attorney General with $200 because that's how much it costs. And then one of the things to get an initiative on the ballot, it has to be circulated by the people, meaning that it has to get signatures. Now, you may have encountered somebody trying to get your signature at a grocery store and whatnot, especially when you go to college. On the college campuses, there are a lot of individuals that are trying to get signatures if you're a registered voter. Now, one of the things is that to have someone collect these signatures, it does cost money. You can have maybe volunteers to do that, or what they usually do is those individuals who are circulating those petitions cost about $1 to $2 per signature, or they pay them $11 to $12 an hour just to circulate that. So if any of you are looking for a part-time job, that may be something you may be able to do. So anyhow, initiative proponents, they have to circulate this measure to get enough valid voter signatures to qualify the measure for the ballot. Now, in order to qualify, they need at least 500 104,000 signatures for an initiative, and to create a constitutional amendment, it's about 807,000 signatures. And so for one individual to get that many signatures is highly impossible, which is why they hire individuals to gather signatures or, you know, hopefully get a lot of volunteers. Now, what is a proposition? A proposition is a blanket term for any ballot measure to be voted on by the people. It can be an initiative or it could be a referendum. Once again, what is a proposition? A proposition is a blanket term for any ballot measure to be voted on by the people. It can be any initiative or a referendum. Now, I have a sample ballot here that I'd like to show you all. This is how an official ballot looks. I like to use this to overhead. If I can have the overhead projector, please, to show this. Okay, wonderful. Let me size it right there. Okay, great. Okay, so this is a sample official ballot, okay, for the state of California, because we're talking about California politics today. Now, as you can see, there's different propositions. Now, whenever we have a general election, even also when we have a primary election as well, they put the measures on the ballot. Now, for here, as you can see, we have Prop 8, and this was for the ballot in 2008, so some years back. This had to do with eliminating the right of same-sex couples to marry. This was an initiative for a constitutional amendment here, is what they had. So individuals had the opportunity to either vote yes or to vote no, depending on where they stand on the issue. Also, Prop 10 allowed for alternative fuel vehicles and renewable energy bonds, which was an initiative. Prop 9, criminal justice system. So individuals who had hurt someone criminally, there was a restitution back to the victim, so victims' rights. So those funds went back to help the people. And Prop 11 is redistricting, was also initiative constitutional amendment on that. So this is a sample ballot. So when I know the majority of you who are watching are in high school. So when you are legal to vote at 18, that's how a sample ballot looks like. Now, there are some very expensive ballot measures. I'm going to go back to the overhead again. If we could take a look at that here. Here at this. Thank you. You can even see my notes here, too. So Prop 87, which would had to do with alternative energy. So they spent about $154 million for this proposition. And the proponents spent about $61 million. And then you see the opponents spent about $92 million. As I mentioned before in the past, to defeat a bill or to defeat a measure, it's really expensive to defeat something unless everyone is on board. Also, too, let's skip down to Proposition number 8, since we were just talking about that, the same-sex marriage ban. $77 million was spent. The proponents spent about $36 million, and the opponents spent about $41 million, and it was passed in that time. And just a quick note, it was passed, but then it was challenged in the U.S. District Court. And then it went to the Court of Appeals, and then they tried to get the case heard in Supreme Court, and then they deemed it to be unconstitutional. So actually, it actually has been repealed, and this had to do with Amendment number 14 about life, liberty, and due process, which was one of the reasons why they were fighting that. Okay, so going back to ballot measure campaigns, Proposition 86, tobacco tax. Creating a more tax on tobacco. You can see how much was spent here as well. You have about $82 million. The proponents spent about $16 million. The opponents spent about $66 million because obviously they don't want to hire a tax on their tobacco. And then Proposition number 38, which is school vouchers. Now, over here, I know I have another page that I would like to share. Let me see if I can find it. So this is California politics that we're talking about, and I find this to be very interesting on how we put propositions up on the ballot and whatnot. Now, going back to some more, you know, popular propositions, going back to this one here, over to the overhead once again. Okay, here we go. All right. So I mentioned Prop 8, Prop 215 or 215. Had to do with the medical use of marijuana, since here in California, individuals can smoke marijuana legally as long as it's for medical use, and that was in 1996. Another controversial proposition was 184, which is the three strikes law. which was built and which was made in 1994, and also term limits of state official members. And as we could, you know, as of recently, these propositions have changed. We want to fast forward to recently, 2012, 2 years ago. Actually, there was a new proposition that was created, which was Proposition 36, and that was passed. And instead of having the three strikes law, because a lot of times the third strike for some for a felon, a convicted felon would be, what was happening is that these individuals were getting sent to prison on their third strike for just stealing DVDs. So now, recently, Proposition 36 only allows the third strike to be eligible for that person if it's a violent or serious act. So that person who was selling, you know, stealing DVDs or whatnot, something that was minor, doesn't get sent to prison for the rest of their life because of that. So that was a recent proposition. In Proposition 34 in 2012, it repealed the death penalty. Well, they're trying to repeal the death penalty, but it didn't work. They tried to repeal it to replace it with life of imprisonment, but unfortunately that failed, which I found that to be very odd because we revised the three strikes law and it passed, but we weren't able to repeal the death penalty. So that's just my opinion. And also Proposition 30 about increasing taxes for individuals that make over $250,000 a year, and those that extra income goes back into fund the schools. So why don't we take a look at Proposition 8. Let's take a look at this video about yes on Proposition 8, and then we'll look at no on Proposition 8. Let's take a look at that.
I don't see how same-sex marriage really hurts anyone else. What's the harm?
If Proposition 8 fails, there's a whole bunch of consequences. Did you know that churches that rent out their facilities for marriages could be forced to allow same-sex marriage ceremonies on their properties?
And because the California Supreme Court has made same-sex marriage a fundamental right, legal defenses based on religious freedoms are less likely to succeed.
If Proposition 8 fails, religious adoption agencies may be forced to place children in same-sex marriages or discontinue providing adoption services altogether. That's what happened with Catholic Charities in Massachusetts after its courts imposed same-sex marriage.
Based on past experience, those who oppose same-sex marriage on religious grounds will be increasingly labeled as intolerant and subjected to legal penalties or social ridicule. It's already happening in the debate over Prop 8. Some who support traditional marriage are having their careers threatened. This won't be limited to California, as its powerful influence is felt across the country.
Did you know that nearly all public schools in California provide education about health and sexuality? If Prop 8 fails, children will be taught that marriage is between Party A and Party B, regardless of gender.
Children will be taught that same-sex marriages are the equal of traditional marriages. There will be serious clashes between the public schools and parents who desire to teach their children their own values and beliefs.
If Proposition 8 fails, it will affect everyone. For example, the change of the legal definition of marriage could narrow personal liberties. Some have already been lost, like photographers who prefer not to photograph gay weddings, and doctors who prefer not to perform artificial insemination of gays, even when there are other willing doctors.
It's been said, the right to swing your fist ends where my nose begins. You see, although the argument of redefining marriage is couched in happiness or equal rights, it's really about gaining control, forcing all of us to give up the very foundation of speech and religious freedoms on which this country was founded.
Join me.
Join all of us.
Be wise. Be informed.
It's our future. It's our children's future. Vote yes on Proposition 8.
Okay, so I have some comments here. This is from Allie. Do state constitutions and the federal constitution ever contradict? From the verbiage that I've been seeing, they're very similar. You know, when it comes to public policy, California is actually one of the states who's like a leader when it comes to policy, because a lot of times other states would follow whatever California does. So that's usually what I've seen, but a lot of the verbiage is very similar. So thank you, Ali. This is from Makayla. I've asked, who are your representatives, if you could please share that. My senators are, those are the U.S. senators, Barbara Boxer and Dianne Feinstein. And my representative, my congressional representative, is Linda Sanchez. All three are Democrats. Okay, wonderful. wonderful. Now, who is your state assembly member and who is your state senate? So if you can respond to that question, I'd appreciate it. And this is from Paige. I believe my senator is Marty Block. I know my congressman is Scott Peters. Who decided on the number of signatures needed? The numbers you mentioned seem rather random. Actually, they're about, the first number I mentioned was 6%, and the other number I mentioned was 8%, and that's what they have. It's like in a bill from the Constitution. So those numbers, they actually are reflected of how the makeup of the state is. So those numbers can be adjusted, but that's the rule of thumb as of now. So, okay, this is from Caitlin. My state assembly member is Brian, I think it's Brian Dowell. The state senator is Jim Nielsen. Okay, great, thank you, Caitlin. So I'd be interested in learning who your state representatives are. Now this is from Ember. The state assembly member for Shasta Lake is Brian O'Kadell, and the state senators are Jim Nielsen and Ted Gaines. Okay, awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that. So take a look at who your state representatives are, your state assembly member and your state senate member. Take a look at that. So we just saw a video a little while ago about Proposition 8. Now, Proposition 8 was, there's about $83 million spent on Prop 8, which was a constitutional amendment banning same-sex marriage. The proponents for Prop 8 were trying to keep marriage traditional, and those who voted no, it would have been same-sex. Now let's take a look at a video that says no to Prop 8. Let's take a look at this video. Okay, so that was a very brief video. Okay, so let's continue to talk about propositions and initiatives. So, like I mentioned, an initiative is a brand new law or constitutional amendment proposed and voted on by the people. Now, in California, we use the direct initiative process, which means that there are a required number of signatures that automatically makes the measure to qualify for the ballot. Now, as of recently, there is a 2014 primary coming up in June, and then you have the general election in November. Now, the statewide ballot measures that I have seen so far is Proposition 41 that has to do with Veterans Housing and Homeless Prevention Bond Act, which would allocate funds to help veterans who are in need of housing. Proposition 42 is public records, open meetings, making sure that there's transparency in government. And also, too, there is a ballot measure that has to do with safe, clean, and reliable drinking water, state finance, approval of health insurance rates, which is an initiative statute. And this has to do with individuals who are in the health insurance field, that if they have to increase their rates, that they have to be approved by the insurance commissioner of the state, and they have to actually take a sworn statement to ensure that those rates are true and that those rates are going to increase. Now, a lot of this information you can actually find at the Secretary of State, which is the California Secretary of State. You can find all this information and it also elaborates more about the signatures that one of the students here inquired about. Also, too, there is a measure that has to do with a referendum to overturn Indian Gaming Compact. So that's what we have going on for our June statewide ballot measures that's coming up. And very few. Another thing too that I wanted to note is that we talked about interest groups the other week. Each interest groups have their own legislative agenda. So depending on whose ideas or interests that you follow, you may want to take a look at their website and take a look at their legislative agenda. Now, for instance, I was taking a look at the California Association of Realtors, and this is an example of their legislative program. If you want to take a look at this here with the overview camera, you take a look at this. This is the California Association sponsored legislation. So what they do is each interest group organization has their own agenda. And for instance, one of them is AB 429, Has to do with the retention of the BRE staff, which are the individuals who work for the Bureau of Real Estate. As of recently, these departments just changed, so they want to make sure that they keep the same staff for the BRE. Another one, and also too, you can see who actually created that bill, which was Daley. And this is assembly member, because it's AB, right? So we have Senate Bill, going down over here, Senate Bill SB, Calderon, and AB, Assembly Bill 42, Pereira, and this has to do with debt forgiveness income. So as you know, as of recently in 2007, the federal government enacted the Mortgage Debt Relief Act. So individuals who have to sell their house, which is not worth more than it could have been, so it has to be a short sale, so they get their tax liability forgiven, because whenever there is a sale of a property, the government takes their part, because they get their taxes, because that's just how it works. Another interesting bill that I thought was very interesting, we could take a look at this one here, is squatters, and this is actually pending. This is by elected official Fox, and so anyone who vacant houses, when houses are vacant, what happens is homeless people or individuals go into these properties and end up staying in them. So now there's a law, a proposed law, that'll take a minimum, that it could take, it would actually, under California law, it could take a minimum of 30 to 60 days to evict a squatter. But since there's such an increase of this happening, this can also be a lot sooner. So this is just a sample of proposed legislation. As I mentioned, each interest group has their own legislative agenda. So whatever group you follow, you may want to take a look at their website and see where they stand on certain issues. Okay, so I have a comment here. This is from Gabby. Okay, the yes on 8 video mentioned sex education in schools. Are there any current laws preventing schools from educating students about same-sex education? Not that I know of, Gabby. Offhand, I do not know of that. So I'd have to take a look into that, but thank you. Okay, so who are your state assembly members and who are your state senate members? You can call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. So we're talking about propositions here. Why don't we take a look at Prop 30, and Prop 30 had to do about taxes. So let's take a look at that.
We're Sacramento politicians selling Prop 30, their $50 billion tax increase.
There's no in between. It's either forward, yes on 30, or real suffering by you and really our whole future.
So, what are Sacramento politicians wasting your money on now?
The scandal at California State Parks continues.
A hidden fund scandal.
56 employees took advantage.
Will actually cost $200 billion.
Way too much money.
Hundreds of raises recently handed out.
I don't think it's fair.
Something's going on.
They can't put enough lipstick on this pig to make it look good.
The only thing to fear is giving Sacramento politicians more money to waste. Vote no on Proposition 30. Stop the waste.
Okay, so that was a no on Proposition 30. And one of the things that I wanted to know is that initiative laws, that once a proposition has been put on the ballot and is passed, the laws generally take effect the day after they are approved, unlike bills. So if there was an actual bill presented by the legislature, they don't go into effect once it gets passed by the governor. They don't go into effect until the following year, which is on January 1st. Okay, so that was a no on Prop 30. Let's take a look at yes on Prop 30. Let's take a look at a video on that.
After a decade of gimmicks and deficit spending, California was on the brink of fiscal insolvency.
Then Governor Jerry Brown took office.
Jerry Brown?
He cut phones, cars, travel budgets, and state commissions.
For the first time in California history,
he vetoed the budget and led $16 billion in spending cuts.
California's bond rating is now positive.
And state spending at its lowest level since the 1970s.
We made progress, but we still have very serious budget problems in California. We simply have to take a stand against further budget cuts for schools or for our public safety. To do that, we're going to the people.
The plan asks the wealthiest to pay their fair share
and asks everyone to do their part.
It will help bring California's budget back into balance.
After years of gimmicks and deficit spending.
For every dollar in new revenue.
The plan makes $3 in spending cuts.
Money raised will be audited every year.
To make sure it's being spent wisely.
We can't keep cutting schools and expect our economy to grow.
We're not offering any kind of panacea, and we're not going to get there overnight. But it is time to take a stand to protect our schools and public safety.
Let's take a stand.
Take a stand.
Take a stand.
Take a stand.
Take a stand, California.
Join me in getting our state back on track and investing in our common future.
Now you see the difference of the two videos we just saw, the one that was no on Prop 30 and the one that was on yes. You know, what type, how did you feel, you know, when you saw these video clips, you know? So I'd be interested on learning your feedback and your opinions on how they craft a message to make you feel a certain way about a proposition. Now, I'm pretty sure some of you, or maybe most of you, have not even heard about these propositions unless they were on TV. Now, to put an ad on TV is very costly. And as you notice, at the end of every video, it says paid for by, and that's a requirement. So every time a video, proponing or opposing some type of political agenda has to have who paid for the video. Now, Proposition 30 fortunately passed, which is a yes, so there, it did pass. And I'm actually one of the people who is also affected by Prop 30 because, as you see here, I teach. I'm a faculty member. So they're currently, the CFA, which is the California Faculty Association, is actually working with Sacramento to see how those funds are going to be allocated because they need to come down from Sacramento. And as you know, we do have a large Cal State system. And how does that pie get divvied up with all the faculty members and whatnot? And also it affects teachers, you know, and et cetera. So this proposition is considered to be a landmark so that individuals who are in the services, occupation can receive, a hike, a little hike in their pay. So that's Proposition 30. I have another comment here. This is from Makayla. Thank you, Makayla. My state senator is Ron Calderon, and my state assembly member is Christina Garcia. They are both Democrats. Okay, very good. Now, for those of you who are watching, I'm very interested in knowing who your state representative is, who your state assembly member is, and who your state senate member is. And you could either call in 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. So we're talking about propositions so far. I would like to take a look at a video that shows a summary of the propositions from 2012. Let's take a look at this video.
Of course, the major issue on the California ballot tonight is Proposition 30.
Yeah, that's the governor's proposal to raise the sales tax and prevent more cuts to schools. Now, checking updated numbers, it is really at this moment just a virtual tie. 36% of the precincts reporting, as you can see here, the vote number is almost identical, 50-50 at this point.
And our Leanne Melendez, who is also, of course, our ABC 7 News education reporter, she is watching it all live for us in Sacramento tonight. Hi, Leanne.
Hi, good evening. Well, actually, I'm hearing here that Proposition 30 for the first time this evening is slightly ahead. But people realize here that we can be here for a while because the race is, as you indicated, very close and it's early in the evening and the results are still coming in. And the other thing is that the governor, Governor Brown, who led this effort, has still not shown up here. He's waiting, and of course, everybody wants to hear from him. But earlier, there was a mini rally with education leaders and with lawmakers who supported Proposition 30. For example, one of them was Senate President Pro Tem Daryl Steinberg. Let's hear from him.
Tonight is the end of one difficult chapter in California's history and the beginning of a new and better chapter where we reinvest in people. We say education matters. We stand for California. Thank you. Thank you very much.
To the state superintendent of schools, Tom Turlickson, and talk about somebody who is very anxious to find the results of this proposition, Proposition 30. And he also told me if this measure does not pass, He is sure that several districts in the state will go bankrupt. Now, also on the ballot, there was Proposition 38, another education-related proposition, Molly Munger behind that one, and she issued a statement just a short time ago. Molly Munger said transformational changes take time, and we are committed to staying the course until our state truly does tackle the school funding crisis. Again, that was Molly Munger, who was behind Proposition 38, which we know now has failed. We're still waiting for the governor show up. Governor Brown, he has not. I understand he is in the hotel here in Sacramento. He will, of course, address many of the supporters. I'm live in Sacramento. Leanne Melendez, ABC 7 News.
Okay, Leanne, thank you so much.
Leanne was just talking about Proposition 38, which has been declared defeated. Here are the numbers. No votes, 74%.
All right, now let's take a look at Proposition 34. This is the one that repeals the death penalty in California. It is also losing, as you can see, 55% to 45%, falling further behind as more returns come in. But it's still too close to really call at this point, 36% of the precincts reporting.
ABC 7 News reporter Heather Ishimaro is covering that for us tonight in Sacramento as well. Heather.
Well, Carolyn, the Yes on 34 campaign tells us even though they're trailing right now, they're sure they're going to come back with big numbers. The question will be just how big. They're waiting for what they consider the key Los Angeles and Bay Area counties, those votes to be counted. Prop 34 would replace the death penalty with life in prison without the possibility of parole. That's for convictions going forward, and also that would apply to the 725 inmates currently on death row. They say the death penalty is too expensive and it's a broken system with only 13 executions since 1978. Again, the Yes on 34 campaign is waiting for the key Bay Area and Los Angeles counties to be counted. For now, 34 is losing.
If for some reason it doesn't turn out our way, then we are going to continue this conversation we've been having with the California voters. We know that we have millions of people we need to reach with the facts that the death penalty is costly and that it risks executing an innocent person, and we will continue with that work, and we'll continue working for justice that works for all Californians.
The savings estimates and argue that we need a higher punishment for the worst of the worst, the 2% that get the death penalty. We're talking about the Richard Allen Davises and Richard Ramirez's of the world. If 34 does pass, it will make California the 18th state without a death penalty. Live in Sacramento, Heather Ishimaru, ABC 7 News.
All right, Heather, thanks.
Well, one measure winning big is Proposition 36 tonight. We can show you the numbers. It substantially changes California's three strikes law, essentially limiting the third strike to violent crime.
You can see yes ahead 68% here with 36% of precincts reporting.
Okay, so that provided a very good overview about the propositions that were implemented in 2012. Now, why was 2012 such an important year for propositions is because there was 11 propositions that were on the ballot. Now, a lot of times people tend to, surpass and not take a good look at the propositions that are on the ballots. So 2012, 2 years ago, it really helped to have more ballots, more propositions on the ballot so that individuals can, you know, do more research and learn more about each one and how each one differed. I wanted to note about Proposition 34 once again. It actually failed because what they were trying to do was repeal the death penalty and make individuals replace it with life imprisonment. Now, Natasha Minisker, one of the individuals who was interviewed, is actually one of the leaders on that. They actually opposed the death penalty, and she's from the ACLU in San Francisco. And in my previous organization, which I worked with, she was one of the groups that I would work with the ACLU and with Amnesty International when it comes to the death penalty, because I was working for an organization that was against the death penalty and wanted to replace that with life life imprisonment. And any of you who are interested in that type of law, you could take a look at ACLU, you could take a look at Amnesty International, because you do great work in this area, you know, however you feel about the death penalty. So maybe in the future, they might decide to, reintroduce that legislation again, so who knows. So there's quite different propositions that were on the ballot in 2012, and we'll probably see some more interesting ones in the near future. But as you can see, to put like a commercial, you know, on TV or anything like that, it costs money. It's very expensive. So definitely there's a lot of individuals who are involved, a lot of interest groups that are involved to, put that money up so people can learn about it. Because as I mentioned, a lot of times people don't, really learn about the proposition until it's on TV or it's on the radio or people talk about it or whatnot. So one of the things I wanted to mention is I've asked all of you, who is your state representative? Who is your state Senate member and who is your state assembly member, if you can share that. Now, Mikayla recently shared that her state senator is Ron Calderon. One of the things I wanted to mention about State Senator Ron Calderon, he's actually also my state senator as well from my district. And actually, Ron Calderon is having some problems. He's having some problems with the FBI. What's happening is that the Calderon family, just a quick note, there is Tom, there is Ron, and there's Charles, and the nephew of Ron is Ian, and they all have to do with politics. And currently, Ian is actually a state assembly member, who actually is also my assembly member from where I'm at. But anyhow, Ron Calderon is having issues with the FBI doing to bribes. So he's actually being investigated by the FBI because they have some evidence that shows that he was getting paid by special interest groups to vote in a certain way. And as you know, that is illegal. And so currently, Ron Calderon has taken a leave of absence. And we as taxpayers are still paying for his salary until he terms out. And he's actually going to term out in November. So it's going to be interesting to see who is going to who takes his position next. But he's currently on a leave of absence. So this really brings in the question on effective government. Now, if you were familiar with that, maybe you can comment about that, Mikayla, but any of you who are watching, you may want to take a look at the LA Times, because it has been coming out in the LA Times a lot as of recently due to corruption charges. And I wonder how this might affect other family members. Who knows if he does get charged, with corruption, who knows. But we'll just see and, follow how this story evolves. Okay, so thank you. All right, so this is from Katie. I have a comment here from Katie. What is the average California voter turnout for the propositions? Is it historically higher in Los Angeles or in the North? I'm not too sure. I'd have to take a look at that, but I'm not too sure what the voter turnout is, because I would think LA is higher because we have more people in the LA area. So that's something I have to take a look into, but thank you. Any other comments, please feel free to call 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. So we were watching videos on different propositions. We saw Prop 30, we saw Prop 8. How did you feel when you saw, the proponents for a certain proposition and the opponents from the proposition? And this is from Abigail. Abigail mentioned, I thought it was interesting how the video that wanted you to vote yes on Prop 30 was upbeat, used light colors, and had happy music. The other one was dark and grim and played depressing music. It was as if the people who made the video were hoping that the video effects would change the voters' mind. Very good observation. And that's what happens. The use of colors, the tone, the language, all of that definitely portrays a certain image on how they want you to vote on for the proposition. So very good observation. Now, this is from Gabby. The first video was ridiculous. They made it look like a horror movie ad. The second one was easy to watch. It made me feel like I was in good hands. It was more officials. Okay, good. Thank you very much, Gabby. Any more comments or suggestions, you can call in or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. So why don't we stop here and why don't we take a 5-minute break and we'll come back.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world. And I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world. And to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school is for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Okay, and welcome back. So today we're talking about California politics. I did want to point out, for those of you who are interested in learning more, there are some great resources that are out there. One of them is Rough and Tumble. If I could have the camera showing the monitor here, you could take a look at each date, the different things that are in the news that have to pertain to California politics. And also, too, for those of you who are in the LA area, just a moment, here it's Rough and Tumble. That's RT, that's rtumble.com. And then there's lavote.net. So for those of you who are in the LA County area, our county recorders is where our votes get processed. And for those of you, I know I have a student in this class who's interested in running for office someday. There's information here about running for office and about filing and whatnot, because we do have a primary coming up. So you can go to Voting and Elections, or you can click here for more information. That's lavote.net. And for those of you who are living in other counties, you could just Google county recorders in the county that you're living in. And I would like to introduce to you our guest speaker for today. We have Mr. Rudy Bermudez. He is our former state assembly for the 56th district from the years 2002 and 2006. I'd like to welcome Rudy Bermudez. Welcome to our show.
Thank you.
So what do you think about LA Vote? What else would you like to comment about this great website that our students and our people can access?
Well, let me start with Rough and Tumble.
Okay.
For a lot of legislators, we turn to Rough and Tumble to catch up on all the latest gossip. Not just the gossip, but also articles of fact, because they'll have articles from all over Southern California and Northern California and the Central Valley. So it's been highly beneficial for us to catch on what's going on throughout the state of California. And of course, provide some gossip on all the other assembly members, senators, and local electeds. Now, LA Vote is an outstanding site that the Los Angeles County Register Recorder's Office has put together, and it has all the essential information that you need, whether you're running for a local office, a statewide office, or a federal office.
Got it, running for congressional. And also judges too. I saw that they have district judges and whatnot who are running for office, that they also go through that as well. So it's a very good website. I do highly recommend for those to do some research and learn more about it. Recently, we were looking at state assembly positions. And for those who want to run for state assembly, it's actually 10% of the salary. So you had to pay the fee, which was about $951.19. Paying the fee up front and then getting nomination papers and having to get at least 40 valid signatures from the district where the person is running in order to be eligible and have their name on the ballot. So for those of you who are interested in running for elected office, you may want to take a look at that, because there's little, tad bits of information that one has to follow for one to be elected into office. Now, Rudy Bermudez, I want to ask you, because you were an elected official, you were a state assembly member representing the 56th district. So what motivated you to get involved into politics? Let's start from there. How'd you start in getting involved into politics?
Well, I think it all began, in my youth with my parents, who were very informed individuals. And at the dinner table, we would discuss the issues of the day. And my brother was a lot older than I, and was off during the Vietnam War and the mandatory draft, and at the same time, Southern California was having this great movement going on of within the Latino community, and the Vietnam moratorium marches and throughout Southern California as well as Northern California, but it really got people involved, and my father was working for the automotive industry with the UAW, United Auto Workers, Local 230, and he was the CAP, which was the Political Action Committee chair. or one of the chair, one of the board members of that committee, and so he was always involved in a number of races, and I was able to meet a number of legislators at a very young age. So I think that was really the embryonic stage of my political involvement. Then went dormant, well, mm-hmm. you know, in high school, and then went on to college. And while I was at Long Beach State, California State University, Long Beach, I had an opportunity to sit down and have lunch with Cesar Chavez.
Oh,
and,
wow.
And it was about seven students and myself, and we spent 2 hours just picking his brain, talking with him, hearing stories, and he signed a book for us each and of his autobiography. But more importantly, it really instilled the values of hard work and commitment to the community, as well as commitment to your education, because that's actually the stepping stones that you need for public office. And then on to UCLA, where became more involved, and after I graduated, I met a very charismatic senator at the time, by the name of Art Torres, and got connected with his team and started working on a number of campaigns, and from there, it took off.
Art Torres, that sounds like a very familiar name. What did Art Torres do?
Senator Art Torres was, he went from assembly to senator, uh-huh. but he was also the state party chair mm-hmm. For a number of years. I want to say at least 8 years or more for the Democratic State Party. Mm-hmm. But he had a number of really important pieces of legislation and dealt with issues of parity mm-hmm. And women's rights issues as well. You know, one of the bills we always laugh about is one that's extremely important for women, and you always wonder, you know, you go to a play or a movie or mm-hmm. or a sporting event, you wonder why these lines are so long for the women.
Yeah.
Well, we always laugh. We call it potty parity, but but he, you know, he drafted a piece of legislation that said uh-huh. that you had to have an equal number of stalls and for women as you do men, and it was, you know, you think about affirmative action or having parity in equal rights, mm-hmm. and it really stems to that, to the essential level of making sure there's enough bathrooms
for
everybody.
Yeah, for everyone.
Yeah, but I mean, he made a number of large pieces of legislation that were very important mm-hmm. to education and insurance and other areas mm-hmm. that, for our community.
That's a great background, and how, you know, how you got started. Mm-hmm. You definitely had a really good foundation. And also, too, about, you know, your experience meeting Cesar Chavez. Now, I just noticed as of recently, there's a new movie that's coming out on his life. Yeah. So, I mean, it's just amazing, and all the stuff that he's done, you know, for the farm mm-hmm. workers and whatnot. So that must have been a very, you know, great experience to meet him and have a conversation with him.
Yeah. No, it was from his fastings to his march. Mm-hmm. All the way up the valley, going straight up the Highway 99, all the way to Sacramento, to the Capitol, and was just amazing. And to hear stories of how they were stopped along the way by county sheriffs, and telling them, you know, they would arrest him if he went any further. And he said, "Fine, arrest me.
Wow.
And, you know, go ahead and take me into jail, but I want to know how you're gonna." How is all these others mm-hmm. that were marching with him?
Yeah.
Because, you know, those local jails didn't fit, you know, the hundreds and hundreds of people that were walking and marching with him. And that's what it would have taken if they had arrested Cesar at the time. So
wow.
It was great stories about a peaceful demonstration and being organized and committed to an issue.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's great. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, going further, you know, you got involved into politics, you know, you had a calling to serve the community. Now, when you ran for state assembly, you know, can you tell me more about that experience and, like, how much money you raised, you know, how much money did you have for your campaign, like, the whole, everything that involved and, you know, when you decided to run for assembly and how it went, and once you got into office, how did that all encompass?
Well, it wasn't just running for the state assembly, I think there was a maturation process in which I went through. I started as a school board member, and in 1990, I kept on wondering why school board members, or why the school district that I lived in, which was Norwalk La Mirada, was hiring strictly their relatives and promoting their relatives up the ladder, and school board members were, using one-time monies, supplemental grant money, which is used for supplementing education and the budget, but they were using it as reoccurring costs and creating a huge budget hole that really would negatively impact our children and the quality of education that they would receive. And I kept on wondering why it was permitted. And so at the time, I was not married, I had no children, and I decided not to wait till I had children, because making change, especially institutional change, takes a long time. Mm-hmm. So in 1991, I ran for school board, raised close to $30,000.
Wow.
And those were $25, $50 contributions, the hard way, the grassroots way. Walked precincts in both cities, in La Mirada and Norwalk, and I would say I probably walked half of both cities during that time, and was the top vote getter in that election, and won. And once you're there, you realize, well, now I'm going to make all these changes. I have this agenda. People elected me for this reason, and I'm going to get this done. And then you find out, well, you're just one of seven votes, and you needed three other members to have a majority of four votes to get anything done. So I went back to the drawing board. I helped four other people get elected.
Oh, nice.
In 1993. And we were successful, and at that point we made a lot of changes. We looked at bringing in performance-based budgeting so we can evaluate programs and their effectiveness, and eliminate duplication of spending. And we put all that savings right back into the classroom for education of the kids, and providing the equipment necessary for our students. We also created a budget scenario in which we had a reserve four times over the state mandate for a reserve, because we wanted to ensure that we never had to roll back the benefits of our employees or the salaries of our employees or the services we provided our students from kindergarten to through high school.
Mm-hmm.
And so we did that and created that rainy day budget. We did a lot of wonderful things. And after 8 years, with the prompting of a number of people, I decided to run for city council in Norwalk, raised over $40,000 for that race. Again, the hard way, $25, $50, $10, a couple $100 contributors, but not very many, and then we won that race. We were the top vote getter again in the race, and we were calling every household, and I was walking the entire city of Norwalk, talking to voters, high propensity voters, and then brought the same formula over with performance-based budgeting. We got some of it done. We reduced the utility user tax that was on the residents, because I wanted to put more money in their pockets and less money on taxes, so that they can put that money back into the economy by going to the barbershop or the restaurants or the dry cleaners, and creating that economic surge within the community.
Most definitely.
And then after 4 years on the city council, I ran for a state assembly, and we raised close to $500,000.
Oh, goodness.
And the average race for state assembly is $300,000 to $500,000, unless it's a highly contested race, then it could go a lot higher in amounts of money.
Wow, so fun. So how are you able to make that jump from, 30,000, 40,000 to 500,000? Like, were a lot of the things that you were doing for school board and city council was a lot of the same things that you were doing, was it the same, or now did you have to contact even more people to get those funds? Like, how did that happen?
Well, if somebody's goal is to make change statewide, then it would be running for a state assembly or a state senate. And in order to get to that level, you have to have a lot of, you have to meet a lot of people and find which ones would be interested in supporting you and your issues. So over a period of time, I met more and more people. And so I met from school districts, you met a number of unions, you met community people, as mm-hmm. well as business people. And then when you went on to city council, you met more business people, more unions, mm-hmm. and you start, your Rolodex of contacts continues to build, and you get to know those people, and then pretty soon they're asking you to run, and and when they ask you to run, you ask them, well, I hope, you know, if I do run, would you be willing to support me?
Of course.
And that's when they say yes, you know. So there's different types of support. You know, people bring volunteers in. Mm-hmm. People can do phoning, and then they can do walking, as well as the contributions. But, you know, the contributions are the milk and honey of politics.
Nice, nice. And now that once you got elected into office, mm-hmm. how was that experience now being in Sacramento and being able to make policy that affects, you know, the lives of California residents?
Well, you know, it was really, for me, it was, I guess, coming full circle, because as a young man, my family took me up to, and my brother, we went on a family vacation, and my parents drove all the way up to Sacramento, and I had the ability to meet our assembly member, which my father had volunteered on his campaign, which was Mr. Joe Gonzalez. And he took me around to the floor of the Capitol, and he gave me a resolution, and it was really nice. And when I got there, because I remember telling Mr. Gonzalez back then, he served in the 60s, wow. And so I was really a young child at the time. I said, I want to come here and work. And he says, oh, I'm sure you will, you know. And then later on in the early 90s, like 92, 93, I had the ability to sit on the assembly floor to listen to a speech by Ronald Reagan.
Oh, wow.
Who was former president at the time. And he gave a speech to the joint session of the Assembly and Senate, and I was a guest of Art Torres on the floor, and I remember telling Senator Torres I was just so enamored with what was going on the floor and the ability to make systemic change, that, mm-hmm. and how you can affect the quality of life of residents, mm-hmm. Of our state. I told him I wanted to get back there and I wanted to work on the floor, and he said, And you shall. And so eventually I made it. So for me, it was full circle. It was really wow. an amazing thing. And I didn't take a minute of time for granted, because I prided myself in reading every bill that I had to adjudicate and vote for on the floor or in committee, as well as I drafted a number of bills that were author-sponsored bills. You have two types of bills. You have sponsored bills, which come from a special interest group, mm-hmm. and then you have author-sponsored bills, which are the creations of the authors. And I prided myself at having about 50% author-sponsored bills and 50% sponsored bills.
Okay, that's good.
I would say 90% or more of the legislators strictly do sponsored bills, which are special interest bills.
Interesting. That mm-hmm. doesn't sound right.
Well, yeah. That's what happens.
Really? Yeah. You would think that once one is elected into office, that you would be the one writing most of the bills, or, you know, maybe you'll definitely get some feedback from the people and your interest groups, but I would think that the majority of the bills that you write would be yours. So,
well, for a number of legislators, mm-hmm. there's a disconnect. You know, they get to Sacramento and there's a disconnect between them and the community, mm-hmm. Or them their situation and the plight of the residents in which they represent. You know, I come from a hardworking blue-collar community, and so some of the bills I carried were bills that, you know, you would look and say, well, why is this? Mm-hmm. You know, why is it like this? And it doesn't have to be this way. And there's got to be a solution for it. And rather than just point out problems, because anyone can point out a problem, it's finding a solution. So one of the bills that I drafted was full-day kindergarten.
Oh, okay, awesome.
There had been a number of studies that showed students who went to full-day kindergarten were more successful mm-hmm. In graduating from high school and going on to college and graduating from college than those who went to part-time or did not go mm-hmm. to kindergarten. So I had a whole bill portfolio of dealing with kindergarten alone. So we started mm-hmm. off with the first bill, and I haven't been able to finish them. Hopefully in 8 years I may be able to go back to the assembly and finish these bills. Uh-huh. But we did one that said we wanted to give school districts the power, school boards. We elect these people to represent us on school districts and do what's best for our children. We need to give them the authority to do it. So one of the things was giving them the authority to go to full day kindergarten without having to ask for permission from the state of California. And so as a consequence, full day kindergarten became an opportunity for all communities. And throughout my district, almost every school district, every school district in my district went on to full day kindergarten, and throughout Southern California, a vast majority of kindergarten classes are full day. You know, kindergarten is one of the only grades, it's fundamental, mm-hmm. but it's one of the only grades that is not mandated that a child attend. Mm-hmm. And for much of the Latino community, we the grandparents or the tias, you know, take care of the children, and they're watching you know, cartoons and uh-huh. other things, and they're not really learning the things that they need to do, reading, writing, and mm-hmm. arithmetic.
Definitely.
So
thank you for bringing that legislation. That's so important. You know, full day kindergarten is mm-hmm. The best thing ever, I think, mm-hmm. instead of a half day kindergarten.
Well, for our community, it's really important, because for working families, and you know, if both the husband and the wife are working, or the caregivers are working, the problem becomes most employers won't allow you to take off in the middle of the day to go pick up your child and take your child to daycare, or take your child from daycare to kindergarten. It's impossible.
Yeah.
So for many people, they didn't attend kindergarten as a consequence. So this was a way of, one, helping the parents stay at work, keep their job,
definitely.
Allow them to work, as well as educate our children so that they're more competitive in this global economy.
Awesome, thank you. And actually, Rudy, you brought a video about how the California legislative bill cycle works. So why don't we take a look at this video on how the bill cycle works for California.
An idea for a law? Tell your state senator or assembly member. If one of them likes your idea, they will author it, and your idea becomes a bill.
Then the bill must be sent to legislative council. Legislative council is a group of lawyers who work for the legislature. These attorneys can take your bill and write it in legal language. Come on, follow me. To make things official, the bill has to be sent to the chief clerk's desk in the assembly chambers. This is where the bill is assigned a number. This is what we call putting a bill across the desk. My bill, Assembly Bill 96, would change the way we classify schools with low test scores. Schools titled low performing schools would instead be called high priority schools. The idea for this bill came from teachers who felt the negative label hurt all students, no matter how hard they tried or how much they improved.
Because Assemblymember Bermudez's bill is about education, the next stop is the Assembly Education Committee. The Education Committee is made up of a smaller group of assembly members who study the pros and cons of the bill. After doing their homework on the bill, assembly members have homework too, the committee holds a meeting called a hearing.
Right now, I'm in one of many committee rooms where hearings are held at the state capitol. At a committee hearing, anyone can tell an assembly member what they think about a bill. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's bad. Here I am at the Education Committee introducing my bill. Let's listen up. This bill would change the terminology
The lower performing school, which is a school that ranks low, a score of 5 or lower.
Now it's time for the public to speak up. Let's listen to some of AB 96 supporters.
I respectfully request an aye vote.
Madam Chair and members, Mike Weimer, California Federation of Teachers in support. We believe that this change in reference is more than just cosmetic because it focuses attention on aid as opposed to punishment. I would ask for your aye vote.
Erica Hoffman on behalf of the Los Angeles Unified School District. Changing the terminology to high priority for these schools literally focuses on what these schools are. They are our highest priority, and we believe this to be important. Thank you.
We have a motion. We have a second. Are there other comments or questions on this issue? Hearing none, Ms. Rupert, call
the roll. The Education Committee votes.
Goldberg. If the bill gets voted down in committee, it crashes and burns.
Cone.
But AB 96 gets Montague. Enough committee votes.
And my bill passes.
Garcia.
If a bill requires the state to spend some money, it must also pass a roadblock called the Appropriations Committee. The Appropriations Committee must okay any bill that requires the state to spend cash.
Fortunately, AB 96 missed that roadblock. The state will not have to spend any money to enact my bill. Next stop, my bill travels to the assembly floor, where I talk to all 80 assembly members and try and convince them that AB 96 would make a great law. Here I go again.
Assembly Bill 96 by Assemblymember Bermudez, an act relating to schools.
Mr. Bermudez, you may open on that item.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, the Academic Performance Index, API, is a statewide ranking system that measures school performance.
Once Assemblyman Bermudez gets done introducing his bill, that's when the fireworks start. Assemblywoman Jackie Goldberg really likes the bill, but Assemblyman Ray Haynes isn't a fan. Check out what they have to say.
Thank you very much, Ms. Goldberg.
I asked for an aye vote because, not because there is any sugar-coated pill or any panacea to any of these problems. But please do not just continue to believe that public humiliation is a very important motivating factor. Public humiliation depresses people, makes it harder to recruit teachers into areas, and it makes young people believe that they are not smart enough to learn. I don't believe this will change a lot, but it'll change a little, and it'll change it in the right direction. I ask for your aye vote.
Mr. Haynes.
Every single time we protect the adults that are failing those children, we fail those children. We do not insist, when we do not insist that those adults actually do their job, when we try to make excuses for them, when we say that because these kids are poor, those adults don't have to work as hard, because those kids grow up in a bad situation, those adults don't have to work as hard. When we say that, gee whiz, we understand you have a lot of obstacles, you don't have to do as good as somebody who lives in my neighborhood, we fail those kids. We fail those kids. And if we start turning around the language and try to make somebody who is doing a bad job, and I'm not talking about the kids here, I'm talking about the adults. We are trying to make the adults feel better about what they're doing, and we ought not do that. We ought to hold them accountable for what they're doing. We ought to vote no on this bill.
Oh my gosh. And it had to be from a Republican, so I just had to say that. But luckily, your bill passed.
Yes, and was signed by the governor. It went through both, when you start a bill, it goes through the assembly, if you're an assembly member. And it's an assembly bill. It goes through the assembly, and then from there, it clears the assembly floor. It goes sent on to the House, the Senate. At that point, the Senate will send it to the same steps, the committee, appropriations, and then the floor. And then once it passes off, if there was amendments, it goes back to the assembly for concurrence of those amendments into the bill. And then if there was no amendments, then it would go straight to the governor. And in this case, the governor signed the bill.
Nice. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Because I know it's hard work on getting your bill passed.
And that's an example of an author-sponsored bill. That bill was brought about by sitting around with teachers and talking about the impact of and the stigma that it gets falls on the shoulders of children when it should not be. So.
Very true. Now, I actually have a comment here. This is from Mitch. Is there still civility in the California State House? It seems harder to build consensus every year. What are your thoughts on that?
Term limits was a cause of it and still is, because there was really no need to sit down and meet with the opposite party. I was a member who prided himself in being able to sit down with assembly members from and senators that were Republican as well as Democrat. I used to go to dinner with opposite parties. I'd put to dinners together that mingled both assembly members and senators and Republicans and Democrats together, and we'd all break bread together and talk. And it was a different group every month, and it was a monthly dinner I would have during the middle of the week, and to promote that. And unfortunately, people, really don't associate, with the other party. And that's the reason why there's so much hostility on the floor.
Very good response. Now, what are your future political goals and aspirations? So now that you have been in assembly, what are your goals? Do you plan on going back to the assembly? Do you plan on running for Senate? Do you plan on running for congressional? What are your future goals and aspirations in the political realm?
Well, I'd like to see, there's a big, there's a problem right now in the Senate and in our district and in the Assembly and the Senate, and I'd like to see that cleaned up. But I'd like to eventually return to do the pieces of legislation that I have that still hasn't been accomplished by any of the other current members. So I'm looking at 8 years and maybe coming back if those pieces of legislation haven't been completed. For instance, full day kindergarten. Mm-hmm. It's the only grade that isn't mandated. And while other countries mandate kindergarten, we do not. And so we need our children to be attending kindergarten, full day kindergarten, and having a curriculum base developed for full day kindergarten. And the only way to achieve that is through legislation, unfortunately.
Got it. So yeah, I'd be looking forward to seeing you back in political mm-hmm. office again. And thank you so much for coming to our show here. And we were talking about California politics today. We have our guest speaker here, former Assembly Member Rudy Bermudez from the 56th District from years 2002 and 2006. And we talked about in the beginning of the program, we talked about propositions and initiatives and how that works. Now, lastly, what are your thoughts about the upcoming governor election?
Well, I think all the polls currently show it's a runaway election. Over 60% of the public are really appreciate the job that Governor Jerry Brown has done. I think as a taxpayer, I like the fact that he hasn't he's held the line on the legislature, both on spending cuts and revenue cuts, as well as spending. Two important issues. He's the only one that's been able to get us out of the problems of which we had fiscally and get us all on the right page.
Definitely. So should people vote anyway?
Yes. There's a number of elections on the ballot. There's a number of judge races. There's a number of assembly races, Senate races, propositions will be on the ballot. Yeah. There's a couple of propositions that are important, but in November there's going to be a lot of propositions that are extremely important to us. And so you need to vote. Elections, can be won and lost with less than 300 votes. And when you look at a district, that's like one vote per precinct or less.
Well, thank you so much, Rudy. And that wraps up our California politics session. Next week, we'll be talking about globalization. Thanks so much.